Okay, all right.
Good evening. We'd like to call the Durham City Council meeting to order at 7:03 p.m. Monday, August the 3rd. And I certainly like to welcome all of you that are here with us this evening. If we could take a moment of silent meditation, please. Thank you. Ask Councilman, lead us in the pledge. Call the roll, please.
Mayor Bell.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden. Councilmember Brown.
Here.
Councilmember Cotati.
Here.
Councilmember Davis.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
And Councilmember Shaw.
We have one proclamation to present this evening. As many of you may or may not know, tomorrow is an annual national event called National Night Out, when neighborhoods across the city gather to meet their friends and neighbors and have an opportunity to speak and meet the city council, members of the police department, et cetera. This proclamation speaks to that event, and who's here from? The proclamation reads, whereas America's National Night Out Against Crime, known as NNO, is a unique crime and drug violence prevention program that is sponsored annually by the National Association of Town Watch and spearheaded locally by the City of Durham Police Department. And whereas on Tuesday, August the 4th, 2015, residents and citizens alike will observe the 32nd annual National Night Out Against Crime by joining forces with more than 16,000+ communities throughout the United States, U.S. territories, Canadian cities, and military bases worldwide. Whereas in all, some 38.1 million people are expected to participate in America's National Night Out Against Crime in Durham. There are more than 100 neighborhoods and community groups that have registered to hold NNO events, signifying neighborhoods' year-round commitment to promote police-community partnership in conjunction with crime, drug, and violence prevention, safety techniques, and neighborhood unity. Whereas the observance is supported by the public safety forces of North Carolina Central University Police, Duke University Police, the Durham County Sheriff's Office, and the City of Durham Police and Fire Departments, who are essential in helping to promote NNO and cooperative crime prevention efforts. Whereas NNO is supported by the active participation and in-kind services of local government, community agencies, and businesses who are committed to the city's mission to provide an excellent and sustainable quality of life. Whereas the City of Durham debuted on the NNO award scene in 2006, and each year following has consistently ranked among the nation's top 15% participating NNO communities consisting of comparable populations, whereas the department, Durham Police Department, extends special appreciation to the 2015 NNO neighborhood coordinators, veterans and first timers, for the extraordinary sacrifice of time and resources to bring police and neighborhoods together under positive circumstances and to demonstrate a true sense of community. Now, I, William V. Bell Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, North Carolina, do hereby proclaim Tuesday, August the 4th, 2015, as National Night Out in Durham, and do hereby call upon all citizens to join the Durham Police Department, its local law enforcement partners, support community agencies, and the National Association of Town Watch in supporting the 32nd Annual National Night Out. Witness by hand, corporate seal of the City of Durham, North Carolina, just the third day of August 2015. I'm going to present this to our public affairs manager, Willie Green. Will Green, thank you for any comments.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I am Will Glenn, the public affairs manager. I stand before you tonight accepting this on behalf of Chief Lopez and also our longtime NNO coordinator, Kimberly Walker. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that Chief Lopez would be standing here tonight if it were not for his 40th anniversary celebrating with his wife this evening. And we all know, if you've been married for any amount of time, that 40 years is certainly an occasion to be celebrating. I do want to mention that Kimberly herself is at our NNO kickoff event, which is our BLET Academy graduation this evening, our 41st. We're actually graduating 25 soon-to-be police officers tonight to protect our community. So that's our kickoff event. I do want to mention that at about this time tomorrow night, nearly 105 communities will be celebrating National Night Out, which is a very important event. It's for one night we celebrate our communities, our citizens, things they've done to keep Durham safe. It is our goal going forward to celebrate more than just one night throughout the year, the things that we're doing in our communities to keep Durham safe. It's also our goal of ours to continue to engage our citizens, to engage our community. We need their help to keep our community safe. So I just want to thank you guys and just mention again that National Night Out is very important, and we will be celebrating tomorrow from 7 p.m. until. Thank you.
Trying to get my tablet to come up, but meanwhile, let me ask other comments by members of the council. Recognize Councilman Shule.
Mr. Mayor, thank you. I see many people here, Mr. Mayor, in the audience who are here who have been protesting at the Residence Inn, and I don't believe that we have an agenda item for that, and I was wondering if they were going to be heard. If not, I do have some comments that I'd like to make, but I wasn't sure what your pleasure was or what your plans were.
I don't see an agenda item for that. If you want to make comments, it'd be appropriate to do it this time.
Well, just briefly, I wanted to say to those of you all who are here, and I wish I spoke Spanish well enough to do it in Spanish, but I want to say that all of us on the council take very seriously the concerns which you all have raised about the non-payment of wages for the construction of the Residence Inn. We are not able ourselves to make any, the council or the city can't be the middle person, the negotiator between you all and the contractor, but I do think there's something that we should do and can do, and that is we have incentivized the construction of the Residence Inn with, if I'm not mistaken, a $500,000 city incentive to keep the historical facade at the Old McPherson Hospital as part of that project. We are not scheduled to make the payment to the Residence Inn anytime soon. We're not pay it until until they start paying taxes, which will probably be over a year from now. But I do believe that until we ought to not be making that incentive payment until we are absolutely 100% certain that the wages have been paid. Again, this is not something we can adjudicate. Someone else has to adjudicate this. Someone else has to figure that out. And I know that there are disputes between those of you who feel like you have not been paid and the developer. But I would want to be certain that the wages have been paid before I think we ought to be making that incentive payment. So just wanted to offer those comments, Mr. Mayor, since it's not on the agenda. Appreciate the people that have come here tonight.
Thank you. recognize Councilman Brown, then the Mayor Pro Tem.
I just wanted to hear from the manager.
That's fine, but I want to recognize Councilperson first, Councilman Brown.
Just to add a little bit to what my colleague Steve Scholl has said, the incentives are not scheduled to kick in until January of 2017. So that is a long time. My suggestion to you as a group is rather simple, and that is I would perhaps go to the CAN organization or some other facsimile organizations and try to get an attorney who will represent your calls, hopefully pro bono, that is to say without charge. We've had this happen before. It's never come before council because that's what these other workers have done. So at least in my judgment, that's your best bet. I know you're upset and I fully understand that. But we're looking way down the road, folks, and you need your money now. So I would go ahead, this is just my judgment on this, and hire an attorney so it can end up in the courts or else you can adjudicate this in arbitration or whatever, but that is your best strategy. And thanks again for coming.
Recognize City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. There is a, or I should say, as I have communicated to you over the last week, the Office of Economic and Workforce Development has continued to try to look into this matter. There is a memorandum from them that I emailed you a short time ago that has a summary of what they know to date. It does appear that it's not the developer, as Mr. Scholl indicated, but one of the subcontractors is where the dispute lies. But ultimately, the process by which that can be adjudicated, somewhat as Mr. Brown indicated, is not through a city investigation. I mean, city mediation. It's going to have to come through a more formal contract dispute or mechanics lien dispute resolution. Maybe Mr. Baker can talk about that. The staff will continue to monitor that. We'll stay in touch, but I'm really absent for what other remedy we as the city council or the city administration can perform at this point other than try to encourage a process that that gets a more formalized review of the dispute. Mr. Baker, I don't know if that anything else to add.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. And I really don't have anything beyond the fact that I would assume that in the contracts between the subcontractors and the individuals who haven't been paid, that there should be some sort of alternative dispute resolution to get to that. But we'll certainly, and my office is looking into this as well, in terms of what realistically can be done, but there's very little on the city side that we can do other than to express the concerns that I think have been expressed already because we're not in privity of contract with these individuals.
Recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
The Department of Labor be a good resource for them at this juncture?
That's a possibility. I don't know all the ins and outs, again, of the relationship or what work was done. I know that there is a dispute, and there are typical ways of going through the process of resolving these disputes.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments on that subject? If not, I have two announcements. One is an announcement, one is a follow-up to a email that I shared with my colleagues on the City Council to include the City Manager and the City Attorney concerning a assistance rental program that I'm suggesting that I'd like the city to look at, targeted primarily for the downtown area and the proposed transit stops within a half-mile radius. I'll speak to that when we get to the staff proposal on some incentives that they have recommending. And I'm aware also that this is an item that's going to be discussed at our work session, but I wanted it brought up at this council meeting tonight for two reasons. One, I thought it was important enough to bring it to this point. And two, the city manager will not be at our work session, so I want to make sure that he's aware, and I've had some conversations with him about that also. But what I'd like to speak to now, some of you may or may not have seen a 60-minute program last night, I think it was last night, concerning the Washington Nationals baseball team, and how, besides the fact they were highlighting one of their leading ball players, they were also speaking about the interest in baseball in this in the city of Washington and what they were doing. And probably most of you, for many of us, baseball has been the sort of American national pastime. And obviously, there's some concern that it might not be attracting the number of fans and to the games that they have. So there's an effort to try to boost baseball. When I attended the U.S. Conference of Mayors recently, they have evolved upon a program with the national baseball teams to really try to promote the value of baseball in communities. And obviously, we're home to the Durham Bulls. It's been a very important part of our economy, part of our culture and entertainment. So during August, mayors across the country are supporting the initiative by focusing on the fun nature of baseball and encouraging participation in the sport, from running bases and playing catch in your own neighborhoods, attending minor league and major league games, and of course with the popularity of our own Durham Bulls baseball team and the Deep App right in our front yard. Promoting baseball is not a difficult task in our community, at least it shouldn't be. So on Friday, we will focus special attention on how much fun baseball is and how it is a sport that teaches our young people valuable life lessons of teamwork, perseverance, leadership, and governorship and sportsmanship. Just prior to the Durham Bulls game on this coming Friday, Friday night between 6:30 and 6:50 on the at the Durham BAP, the what we call the DBYAL Blue Jays, which is a stands for the Durham Bull Youth Athletic League. They will be participating in the Bulls pregame activities on the field. And there will be a special ceremony for recognizing the team members and show our appreciation to the Bulls organization for the commitment to Durham youth. You're all invited to attend. If you can't make it, the public affairs officer will be posting pictures of the city's Facebook pages and on Twitter. Durham is very happy to support this initiative and recognize August 2015, as a play ball month. And again, as I said, most of the cities across the country, especially those that have minor league teams and major league teams, will also be participating. So that's an event that we would invite you out. It's this coming Friday, August, what is it, Friday? The 7th at DBAP. And again, the activity is going to be between 6:30 and 6:50 when we recognize the young people who have been so important and so engaged in the activities of baseball. I'm going to ask now if there are priority items first by the city manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items this evening.
Likewise, city attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items.
Likewise, the city clerk.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. Item number 39 on your agenda, zoning map change, Bell Green Road. Due to the withdrawal of a signature, the protest petition has been ruled invalid.
Accept the city clerk's priority item. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Those voting yes will hit plus.
Passes 7-0.
Thank you. We'll go through the agenda. For those of you who may not have been at our meetings, we go through the agenda. The consent agenda can be passed with a single motion. If a member of the council or someone from the audience pulls an item from the consent agenda, we will discuss that item later in the meeting. And again, I'll just read the heading of each one of the consent agenda items. On the Audit Services Department, Grants Management Performance Audit, June 2015. On the City County Inspections Department, item 2, renewal of the Durham City County Interlocal Cooperation Agreement for Inspections, which is, I'm on the wrong one? That's my tablet going wrong. Okay. I guess you guys were wondering where we were, right? Thank you. That's technology for you. Okay, let's start again. On the consent agenda, on item 1, approval of City Council minutes. Item 2 is the Human Relations Commission appointment. Item 3 is the Durham Housing Authority Board of Commissioners appointment. Item 4 is the Recreation Advisory Commission appointments. Item 5 is the Passenger Vehicle for Hire Commission appointment. Item 6 is the Durham Planning Commission appointment. Item 7 is extension of terms for City Council appointments to the Durham Workforce Development Board. Item 8 is the Mayor's nominee for reappointment to the Durham Board of Adjustment. Item 9 is 2014 Durham Board of Adjustments Annual Report. Item 10 is 2014 Durham Historic Preservation Commission Annual Report. Item 11 is 2014 Planning Commission Annual Report. Item 12 is the Raleigh-Durham International Airport Federal Aviation Administration Grant Offer, FAA AIP Grant Number 3-37-0066-046-2015. Item 13 is additional architectural and engineering services for Southside Homeowners Phase 1. Item 14 is grant agreement for sidewalk construction on NC 751 and NC 54, TIP number U-4726HJ. Item 15 is execution of addendum number 1 to supplemental article number 4 for Jordan Lake Partnership regarding Phase 1 of the Triangle Regional Water Supply. Item 16 is ordinance to correct FY 2015-2016 water and sewer fee schedule. Item 17 is amendment number 1 to contract for computerized maintenance management systems, software, and related services. Item 18 is contract SR 61 sanitary sewer systems repairs 2015. Item 19 is the bid report for May 2015. Item 20 is the bid report for June 2015. Item 21 is installment financing contract series 2015 for fleet. Item 22 is cell tower lease and license agreement with Sprintcon Inc. Item 23 is the lease to the Museum of Durham History at 521 West Morgan Street, Durham, North Carolina, parcel number 103112. Item 24 is temporary staffing services. Item 25 is the contract for athletics booking agent. Item 26 is a contract for rental equipment for paving operations. Item 27 is the private driveway pipe ordinance revision, section 62-92. Item 28 is the brine ordinance revision, section 62-16. Item 29 is Microsoft Enterprise Software licensing agreement. Item 30 is Munis Software annual support and license agreement for 2016. Item 31 is the Frontier Communications Analog Lines Agreement. And items 36 through 41 and 43 are items that can be found on the general business agenda. Entertain a motion for the approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
Second. It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We'll now move to the general business agenda for public hearings. Item 36 is a comprehensive plan amendment for 2512 Vesson Avenue, A1500005.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, Pat Young with the Planning Department. I can first certify for the record that all public hearing items before you tonight have been advertised in accordance with the provisions of law, and there are affidavits to that effect on file with the Planning Department. The case before you is A1500052512 Vesson Avenue. And this is a proposal to amend the future land use map of the comprehensive plan for 0.65 acres of land immediately to the east of Lakewood Elementary School from its current designation of low medium density residential to medium density residential, and to change the applicable development tier from suburban to urban. If approved, this change would allow for the companion zoning map change request, which follows this item, to be considered and favorably recommended by staff. Staff recommends approval based on our finding of compliance with the four criteria for plan amendments identified in the Unified Development Ordinance. Planning Commission considered this item at its May 12, 2015 meeting and recommended approval by a vote of 11-0. Thank you, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. This is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. Let me ask first, are there questions, comments by members of the council on the staff report? If not, are there persons in the audience that want to speak on this item? This is a public hearing. You have an opportunity to speak. If you do, if you could just go to the clerk's desk and then come to the podium right, and yeah, she can sign up your name and address and et cetera, unless you've already done it. This is item 37.
Mr. Mayor, council members, I'm the developer.
36.
Sorry. I'm the developer. I'd be happy to answer any questions if you have. I don't have anything to say about it unless you have questions.
Okay, thank you. Are there questions of the developer? If not, I'm sorry, do you want to speak? Yes, ma'am. What you can do, you can speak and then sign up later after you finish speaking to save time. If you can just give us your name and address, please, and you have 3 minutes.
Thank you very much. I'm Molly Renda, and I'm a resident at 2412 Huron Street, and I just wanted to know if there were plans in place already for the development of these parcels, or is this just a preliminary?
No. When we applied, I had a neighborhood meeting. Sorry.
So that was my question.
No problem. Thank you. When we applied, we had a neighborhood meeting. Really, we had it twice. And what we are presenting is to replace the two duplexes that were non-conforming there with one conforming duplex that will also fit in that neighborhood. So there's nothing unusual in the building itself, and it's only going to be one duplex.
Are there other questions? Again, this is a public hearing. Let the record reflect no one else asked to speak on this item. I will declare the public hearing to be closed. The matter is back before the council. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Those voting for will hit plus. You close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We'll move to item 37, the zoning map change, 2512 Vesson Avenue, Z1500012.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Pat Young again with the planning department. This is the companion zoning case to the previous plan amendment case, 0.294 acre parcel. Located at 2512 Vesson Avenue, located immediately to the east of Lakewood Elementary. The request is to change the zoning map designation from its current designation of residential suburban 10 to residential urban 5-2, which would allow for the development of a duplex. With the approval of the companion comprehensive plan item, this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted policies and ordinances. Staff determines that this request meets all these ordinances and policies, and Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 11-0 at its meeting of May 12, 2015. I'll be happy to take any questions.
You've heard the staff report. Again, this is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. Let me first ask other questions from members of the council. We do have two persons that have signed to speak on this item. Any questions from the council? If not, I'd like to recognize Queen Esther Walker. If you can come to the podium to the right, please. And Jonathan Dyer.
That's me. Diana.
Oh, that's you. That's okay. All right, Ms. Walker, you have 3 minutes.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mayor Bale and the committee. My name is Queen Esther Walker, and I live at the property at 2527 Vesson Avenue here in Durham. And I'm just a concerned neighbor at that residence about the zoning that's going on. And I'm here to listen and be recommended of any ideas that need to take further action on that street at Lakewood Elementary School. Okay, thank you. God
Welcome,
bless.
Welcome, Ms. Besson. The developer is the next speaker, so I'd like to recognize you. You might want to address her questions if you can add any more specifics. Have a seat, Chair.
Ms. Queen, right? Yes. The only difference that's going to happen right now is, if you remember, there were two non-conforming houses, duplexes, on that corner with the school. There were two duplexes that were like, one was perpendicular, sorry, thanks, to the other, right across the street. So we tore those down. They were asbestos buildings. We tore them down, and we're planning to put one duplex there instead of those two. That's the whole. That's the only deferring issue that would compare to what you had there before. We need the map change to allow us to build the duplex with the setbacks that the city guidelines guide us to do. That's the only thing we're asking for.
Okay.
Other than that, I don't know of any other plans for that street. Maybe someone from planning department could address that.
Ms. Walker, if you're going to speak, I'd ask you to come to the microphone. So it's fine. I just want to make sure you're on the record. All right. Does the staff have any comments?
Sure, Mr. Mayor. Thank you. There's no current other pending proposals for rezonings or use permits on that street. The future land use designation is consistent with the uses that are being proposed by the applicant tonight.
So there are any other persons that want to speak on this item, this being a public hearing matter? If not, let the record reflect that no one else asked to speak. I would declare the public hearing to be closed. The matter is back before the council.
Move the item.
Second. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Those voting for will hit plus. Will you close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
Move the consistency statement.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Again, those voting plus four will hit plus. Will you close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We move to item 38. Zoning map change, Garrett Ridge Multifamily Community, Z140022.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Pat Young again with the Planning Department. The case before you, Z140000022 Garrett Ridge Multifamily, is a request to change the zoning map designation of 10.18 acres located at 4904 and 5010 Garrett Road, which is on the west side of Garrett Road, just north of Old Chapel Hill Road, from its current designation of residential suburban multifamily to residential suburban multifamily with modified committed element to allow cross access between two properties under common ownership. Each of the parcels involved in this request were zoned in 2001 and 2007 respectively with residential suburban multifamily with a development plan. And at that time, the committed elements associated with those cases did not allow the requested cross access. So this item before you would allow that access to be provided. Staff determines this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted policies and ordinances, and the Planning Commission recommended approval of the item at its May 12, 2015 meeting by a vote of 10-1. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Again, this is a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. I would ask the comments by members of the council on this item. If not, we have one person that has signed up to speak. Is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item? If not, I recognize Ron Harvath, and you have 3 minutes, Ron.
Thank you, Mayor Bell, members of council, Ron Harvath, 16 Consultant Place, Durham. This is to bring two projects that were approved separately by different developers, or it's now under one developer, and he'd like to connect them with driveways, and that's the only purpose. I'll be glad to answer any questions. Thank you.
You've heard the developer recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This may be a question for the staff or the developer. I'm not sure who's the best able to answer it, but so it looks to me like the applicant is saying that they've got a rezoning request in process, which we will presumably see at some later time, which would allow him to put 132 units on the property. Can you explain that? Have I got that right?
Both properties are either developed or under development. And what the future rezoning would do is ensure that the future land use map designation is consistent with the number of units that are being developed. The applicant may wish to speak to the circumstances behind that situation.
Mr. Shule, the number of units are in the current two parcels that are being joined together by a driveway. That's the total number of units. There's a future third parcel that we also want to connect to because we are bringing another case forward. We don't want them dumping out onto Garrett Road again. We want to keep all the traffic internal, and they will be under one ownership.
So is that what the rezoning is about?
No, this rezoning is strictly about the
driveway
connection.
No, I understand. This future rezoning that was mentioned in the...
Is additional multifamily units on the third parcel.
Okay.
Yes.
So that's the difference between the 114 and the 132, I would presume?
Yes.
Thank you. And The developer is dedicating 15 feet of public right-of-way along Garrett Road. There's no sidewalk there, I'm remembering, and
no.
So dedicating right-of-way but not putting in a sidewalk?
Oh, no, the sidewalk's going in, and the road is being widened to three lanes across our entire frontage, including the future parcel.
All right, thank you. I missed that, but that has been proffered?
I don't know if it's proffered, but it's being built now.
Okay, well, that's better than proffered.
Yes.
Thank you. And then just want to observe that it's great that there are going to be 10 bike parking spaces, but it's hard to, this is not a very bikeable area without bike lanes. So I just want us to keep that in mind. It's great to have bike parking, but
we're doing our part with widening the road and providing bike lanes in our section, but
that
beyond
is,
that.
Yeah, you are doing your part for that, but I appreciate it, but did want to observe that. So the mulched walking trail is going to, as I read this, go sort of connect with a 40-foot sewer easement?
Yes, we have a sewer easement going out the back to that 40-foot easement that occurs in the core property, and that is a future trail.
Okay, that's what I wanted to know. Fabulous. Glad to hear that. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor.
Are there other comments? Persons that want to speak on this item? Do you want to speak on this item, sir? I tell you what, you can go to and state your name and address, and then you can sign the card. Is it on this item you want to speak?
Yes.
Here, if you can just state your name and address, and then we can fill out the card later.
Okay, I'm Doug Daffron at 4752 Garrett Road, and I'd just like to know, I have the property behind the Fred Astaire Dance Studio up on the hill. And when you mentioned the walking path, I'm just kind of curious where that walking path is going. Is it going down where the Corps of Engineers is, where the
yeah.
that part is going? And will it go through your, from your park to the end of it, or?
No, just back to the sewer easement. Just back to the sewer easement at the Corps property.
Okay.
It runs down through here.
Okay, it runs down back in here.
Yeah.
Because usually it goes right through here.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm just a little curious. And how many, and what kind of units are these? Are they similar to the ones at Tycon?
Tycon is a developer.
Okay, got
They're
it.
They're expanding
so,
that same
got
development.
It. Okay, I'm just curious. I just wanted to know what's going in that area since I'm right behind them. Thank you very much.
Other questions? Is anyone in the public that wants to speak? Let the record reflect that no one in the public asked to speak. I declare the public hearing to be closed. The matter is back before the council.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Again, those voting for will hit plus.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Those voting for will hit plus.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Properly. So, the city manager just gave me his. So the next item is item 39, zoning map change for Bell Green Road, Z1400026.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Members of Council, Pat Young again with the Planning Department. The case C1400026 Bell Green Road is a request to change the zoning map designation of 23.8 acres of land located at 823 Bell Green Road, which is at the eastern terminus of Bell Green Road at Silver Star Drive, from its current zoning map designation of residential suburban 20 to planned development residential or PDR 4.010. And this would allow for the development of 95 single family lots. The request is consistent with the future land use map designation for this area, which is low medium density residential, 4 to 8 units per acre. The development plan associated with this request does include a commitment to limit the housing type to single family and accessory uses to single family, and graphically commits to the general location of site access points and tree preservation areas. Staff determines this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted policies and ordinances. And the Planning Commission recommended denial of this item at its June 9th meeting by a vote of 8-3. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Okay, you've heard the staff report. Let me ask first, do members of the council have questions? Recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess I want to know from the staff, based on the Planning Commission meeting, what was the nature of the mentioned that the development was not reasonable, not in the public interest? I don't know if you recall what the reason for those concerns were.
Sure, thank you, Councilman Davis. You characterized the finding of the Planning Commission, which was that as part of the recommendation of denial, the Planning Commission found that this case was not in the public interest for two primary reasons based on the discussion at the meeting. One was neighborhood concern about transportation impacts, and the second was that neighborhood concerns about the density of the development being out of character for the adjoining area. Those were not reflected in the staff report because there wasn't that wasn't directly consistent with the adopted policies, but that was the concerns expressed at the Planning Commission by neighboring citizens and that the Planning Commission took into account.
Other questions by members of the council? If not, we have two persons that have signed up to speak as proponents of this program. We have three persons that have signed up to speak, two people have signed up to speak and opposing the program. The reason I'm saying that, I'm trying to find out are there other persons that want to speak so I can determine how much time I'm going to allow for this. So is there anyone who wants to speak on this item that has not signed up to speak as a part of the public hearing? Okay, we'll go with what we have, and I recognize first the developer. Let me set a time on this. Let's try 10 minutes first for the proponents and opponents, and then we'll adjust that as it goes.
All right. Number two, yeah, right
there. And then this turns us off. If the developer and proponents will identify yourself, your name and address.
Sure. I'm Attorney Floyd McKissick, 835 North Mangum Street, Durham, North Carolina. It's my law office. I'm here today on behalf of the applicant. In support of this particular rezoning request. I believe it's a reasonable request, and I have a PowerPoint presentation. We'll try to go through it real quickly to give people an overview of where this site is located. One of the first things I did when the developer came to me was to take a look at the site and see exactly whether it was an appropriate site for the proposed use that we anticipated here, which was in conformance with the comprehensive plan. Comprehensive plan anticipates 4 to 8 units per acre on this particular site. What we have here is a site that's right behind the UDI Industrial Park off of Bell Green, and likewise it's situated in a location where it's 23.8 acres of open space today. The proposed use is for 95 single family lots. It's anticipated that based upon the size of the lots, what you're likely to see is very affordable homes built in this particular location, probably the most affordable market rate single family homes that you will see in Durham, built on this side of MLK Parkway going toward South Point. Developer has proffered to limit the site to single family homes and accessory uses. Developers proffered that the general locations for access points will be provided, and likewise tree preservation areas. There's about 20% tree coverage, which is being specified of about 4.75 acres. The development is totally compatible with all the existing uses. One thing which I did before I even agreed to help this particular applicant with this case was to go out and look at the site. I looked at it one Thursday morning during peak hours, and this is an overview of the site itself in terms of an aerial. If you look at that, you'll see that Bell Green is right there intersecting with Federal Road. You'll see this track of land here, which is pretty straightforward. I can try to identify it a little bit better on that map there, being in that area, if you can see that a little bit in that vicinity. In any case, when I looked at it at 7:45, 8:15 in the morning, no traffic issues. Came back the next day, 2:30, 3 o'clock, no traffic issues. Came back at about 5 to 7, there were no traffic issues. We have a site here where Bell Green is a type of thoroughfare. It's about 32 feet wide right now. Curb and gutter is in place. If you had to come up with a compatible use between this light industrial area and between the existing single family in the area, you could not find a better transitional use than medium-density housing as proposed in the comprehensive plan. I've personally worked on three updates of comprehensive plans here in Durham, and it makes sense to logically put that type of development here. The single-family detached housing that's proposed is at the low end, the very low end, only 4 units per acre, completely compatible with the duplex housing, medium-density townhomes, and single-family homes that are back behind it. The developer has basically indicated that since it will generate an additional 19 students, that they will donate to Durham County Public Schools $10,000 to offset that cost. That is in excess of $500 per student. Likewise, the developer, in light of hearing some concerns that have been addressed, has agreed that they would also provide sidewalks. Sidewalks going down the entire length of the site, all the way down to Federal Road where American Tobacco Trail is, at additional cost to developer, and that would be constructed after the 40th lot and development is done. The increased traffic here, we're talking about probably 529 trips per day. If you look at that over a 24-hour cycle, it is relatively insignificant. If this thoroughfare were a rated thoroughfare, it would be probably rated an A or a B. This particular photograph here shows you one element of the site. If you can go a little bit further here, the next site, you can see the site frontage there going along Bell Green. That's the site going all the way down toward Federal Road. That's a house that adjoins the site. That's the UDI Park, and that's where it intersects with Federal Road. That's an intersection you may all be familiar with. Federal Road is scheduled to be 4-laned in this area from Riddle Road going all the way up to Barbie. That is scheduled to occur within the next year. Once that is done, there will be right outs only leaving Bell Green going on the Federal Road, and likewise right ins only occurring. The traffic issue here is more about apprehensions. It's all about fear. It's not about real traffic generation numbers that can be factually substantiated. This would be a thoroughfare rated, as I say, an A or a B if it were rated. So we would ask for your support. I have Mr. Tata here, Tony Tate, who can, I've been dealing with Tata for so long. And he's not that bad of a guy. He's actually pretty reasonable. But Mr. Tate, if you could come forward as an architect for this project, and he'd be prepared to answer any other questions, provide some overview of interaction with the homeowners in the area.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. I am Tony Tate, one letter off from the Transportation Secretary. Just wanted to say that my firm is the firm that presented the plans and the applications to staff for this particular project. And just want to say that, you know, it's bound on the north side by an industrial park, multifamily apartments. And so, you know, just by, you know, the way typically we look at planning is that you step down from those industrial uses to a zoning categories and designations that make sense, and you step down from your density from the highest to the lowest. And we feel like that's what we're doing here with this particular project. And so it has access to Bell Green Road. You know, early in the process, we've had two neighborhood meetings, and we've met some good folks. We've had some good conversations. We've answered a lot of questions and tried to understand their concerns, and understandably, you know, people have concerns, and so we've tried to address those. I don't want to go over anything, but hold some time left, but you know, we meet all UDO requirements, and we meet the comprehensive plan, and you know, in my opinion, I feel like that what we've proposed is what the city has set out for that particular site, as again, as we step down in transition and zoning. So I'd like to hold any additional time that we have left to answer your questions or questions from the neighborhood. So thank you.
Do any of the council members have questions of the developer at this time? If not, then we'll move to persons who want to speak in opposition. Well, Bill Ripley, you had signed up. Were you a part of this?
Mr. Ripley liked to reserve his time.
These persons are signed up to speak. Australia Clay, Deborah Morgan, Pam Oxidine. So if you proceed to the podium to the right, and again, state your name and address for the record. Based on the fact that we have three people, 3 minutes for each one at a time.
Okay, good evening. My name is Pam Oxendine. I live at 5032 Robinwood Road. We had met with the Planning Commission a couple of months ago, and we heard about the development, and they asked us to meet with the developers, and we did. We had a couple of concerns, the neighbors, and a couple of neighbors are here that have been in the community for over 30 years. When we met with developers, our key question was what type of homes. They didn't have a plan at that point, and I assume that they still don't have a plan of what type of homes were going to go there. The other thing was we wanted to know the value of what was the homes that were going in there. They weren't able to answer that either. Our main concerns were three: safety, property value, and traffic. The safety on the issue there, we have several children who ride the bus, to take the bus right there at Bell Green as well, and there's a lot of kids in that area, so that was one of our concerns. And we mentioned the sidewalk issue. The other issue was wanted to know, of course, the property value, but our main issue was the traffic. If you double the density in this particular area, and you have to really know this area. I go out every morning to work, so I know where what happens there. I just don't go one day a week. The developer's attorney was telling you that it meets, Bell Green meets with Fayetteville. It also meets with Barbie Road. There's a park right there, and there's also a tobacco trail. So there's a lot going on in that corner. But the main thing is we asked the developer, is it another way to have another street to go out? Because there's nowhere else to get out. You double the density in there, you're going to landlock people. You're going to put more people in a smaller area to get out. Bell Green is the only street that gets out to Fayetteville directly. They can go other ways, but they have to go into the community of Lockside. So they would have to go in between and down streets to get out. So that's why we asked the Planning Commission not to approve this rezoning, because of that reason. It would double the density of the people in there, and it would increase the traffic in the area, and it will not have the quality and the character of the neighborhood that is there now. So when you look at Bell Green, Fayetteville, if it wasn't a traffic problem, they would not be expanding Fayetteville. It's a huge issue right there already with traffic every morning. So what we asked the developer was to look at possibly another street that could take the people out that are going to be in this area. It looks really pretty on the, when you look at it like that on the paper and on the PowerPoint, but when you actually out there and you see that land and how it's landlocked, it's not so pleasant. I can't see how even people would want to live in there and not be able to easily get out. That's the issue right there, is that being able to get out. We are asking the neighbors in that area, Robinwood, Bell Green, and even Lockside, and also Orindo, thank you. Oh, my time is up. That you would not approve this rezoning. Thank you.
You're welcome. Deborah Morgan.
I'm Deborah Morgan. I live at 3401 Ranbier Drive in Durham, also in the community of Lockside. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to present our concerns about this rezoning request. If you didn't see the email I sent earlier today with our unofficial protest petition, I have it right here. We have 118 signatures from homeowners who oppose this rezoning, including 85% of the single-family homes in Lockside. They all could not be here tonight, but wanted a way to have their voices heard as well. So on their behalf, I'm going to try to summarize our concerns about this rezoning request. We would like the parcels in the rezoning request to be developed under the current RS-20 zoning. The rules for developing under RS-20 provide limitations on the number of homes, lot size, and setbacks that we're comfortable with. Under the proposed zoning, there are just too many unknowns about lot size, what type of product would be built, etc. And once that's been ironed out, there's no opportunity for our input. We believe that if it were developed as a cluster subdivision, like the single family homes in Lockside, that would allow plenty of buffering from the adjacent, more intense uses. We understand the concept of going from more intense uses to less intense uses, but we think that makes sense when the higher density development has access to higher capacity roads like Martin Luther King. This property does not border a higher capacity street like MLK. It's in the back corner of all RS-20 properties. The proposed rezoning just about doubles this density and would add an additional 529 trips a day through the adjacent RS-20 neighborhoods. Because Bell Green Road is right in, right out, any traffic leaving this site that wants to go south must come past the front doors of the RS-20 homes. They can come down through Lockside on Silver Star Drive, which doesn't have speed humps, or they can go down Robinwood Drive, which does have speed humps. We also believe that more traffic on Bell Green Road is a safety issue for pedestrians because there isn't a sidewalk, and we're glad to hear that this developer has decided that it would be a good idea to do that sidewalk. And I'd also like at this time to thank the Bicycle Pedestrian Advisory Commission for making that comment that would be a good thing. I appreciate the time those volunteers put into reviewing these plans. And I think if this goes forward and there's a sidewalk, we have them to thank for their efforts as well. So we would like to see whoever develops this property take the safety of these children. Let me back up. The middle and high school students, as well as the school of the arts students, are dropped off at the corner of Bell Green and Fayetteville Road and walk down Bell Green Road. We'd like to see whoever develops this property take the, We just like for it not to be rezoned. We want to keep it under the current RS-20 and developed that way.
Thank you. Australia, Clay.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, members of the council. Let me agree with both ladies who have just spoken. I live at the corner of Robinwood Road and Bell Green Road. I've lived there now for almost 30 years. My major concern is the safety of the children who wait on that corner. I stand out usually to parents because I'm retired. They'll say, watch my children, make sure they get on the bus, make sure they don't go any other way, and make sure they're safe, which I do. And by cell phone, I can let those parents know. I'm concerned about those children who walk up Bell Green to catch the bus on the corner. Sometimes when it's raining, I will take some of those children and wait for them to catch the bus on that corner. I beg to differ with the attorney who spoke about the traffic at the end of Bell Green. Peak time, you cannot get out of Bell Green. In the afternoons, you cannot get back in Bell Green. And the traffic is heavier on Bell Green Road. If there are 95 single-family buildings, houses, whatever they're going to be, that's going to add more traffic to Bell Green Road, to Robinwood Road, and also going through Lockside Silver Star. Silver Star has been kind of a well-kept secret because people haven't always known that it's a through street. But my main concern is safety. My main concern is property value, too. And I'm also concerned about our trees. We need to keep some trees around because all our trees are going and our animals' environment is being invaded. I agree with the ladies. So everything they have said, you can add to my speech too. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
You're welcome. That's all the persons that have signed up to speak on this item. Is there anyone else that wants to speak that did not have an opportunity to sign up? If not, developers have how much time? 3 minutes? If developers would like to speak. The Mayor Pro Tem. And then Councilman Brown.
I would like for the developers to speak to the issue of quality and quality of the development and safety.
Yes, ma'am.
And the price range, yes.
All right, he's going to figure this out, and I'm going to talk to you a second. The ladies are correct. We did not. I'm sorry. Excuse me. Bill Ripley, 5011 South Park Drive here in Durham. We did not discuss any particular product other than the fact that we are building single-family homes only. We did in our neighborhood meetings express that the homes would be similar to the homes in Lockside as far as size and as far as price. They will, in best case, there will, well, in a general format, there'll be 3 to 4 bedroom, 2.5, 3.5 bath, 2-car garage, 2-story homes. So I don't think there'll be anything negative to the aspect of these, the construction of these homes. It will be energy efficient. They will be built with, in today's world, most of it's the cement siding and some stonework that we see typically in most new neighborhoods today in Durham, Cary, Raleigh. So if that helps answer that question, we're not trying to do anything that would be unsightly. I think that we have to sell these homes. We have to have homeowners that want to buy them, so they have to be attractive, and I think they'll fit in contemporarily with the Lockside neighborhood. Wanted to point out traffic. Can we get this map? And I don't know how to get on these. Bell Green does exit and interchange at Fayetteville Road. And that will be the predominant way to folks that out of this new neighborhood will exit. Of course, there's 3 other ways to go out, and that's, as the neighbor said, some of the folks will go down Robinwood toward Arendo, down to Barbie. Others will go out Silver Star to Yorktown and come out the stoplight at MLK, and others will go all the way through to 55. But if I lived at Bell Green, the easiest way, if you want to go downtown Duke, RTP, Raleigh, South Square, you're going to go Bell Green, go north on Fayetteville, and straight into downtown, left on MLK to go to South Square Duke, or right on MLK to go to the park. So the peak hour traffic, which is the most concern for everyone, will be going to MLK, and we have a great road there, 4-lane divided, and Fayetteville Road will be 4-lane divided. So I think the neighborhood traffic for 95 homes, when Lockside, the neighborhood to the south, is 185 homes. We're not going to generate as much traffic as the existing neighborhood that was built in 2007. So I think we are compatible. It's a great location. We have Solight Park. We have AT&T Trail. We have Pearson Town School. It fits the use for the location, and I think it'll be a great asset for Durham. Appreciate your support.
The other question is, tell me where the sidewalk will be constructed and where the kids, as it relates to where the kids get the bus.
I don't know if you can you see this on your screens? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. If you look at number one, the site there is the kind of orangish site with a red line around it.
Mm-hmm.
From there all the way, the blue line that goes to Bell Green to Fayetteville, we have agreed and have a committed element. We're proffering a committed element to build the sidewalk from our property all the way to the trail sidewalk at the interchange of Bell Green and Fayetteville.
Now, do I understand that that's where the kids get the school bus? But there is no sidewalk there now.
Okay.
All right. I have a question for transportation. Could you share your opinion on the traffic congestion that would be generated by this development, please, sir?
Yes, the neighborhood with 95 homes is projected to generate about 1,002 trips per day. The existing Bell Green road has a capacity of close to 10,000 vehicles per day, so it's really not going to generate a capacity problem. I think a lot of the neighborhood concerns are sort of a quality of life perception. They're used to a few hundred vehicles per day, so when you add a few hundred more, they see it as a significant increase or change, but it won't be a capacity problem.
Second, when do you anticipate the street improvements for Fayetteville will be completed?
So the Fayetteville improvements are from basically from Barbie Road north, which will include the Bell Green intersection. They are acquiring right away now, and I believe they hope to let that project sometime in the spring or spring of next year, mid-spring or summer next year.
Okay.
For construction.
Okay. All right. Could you speak to when the development is planned to be completed or begin?
It's anticipated that there might be clearing activity that will begin in the fall of this year, but major construction of infrastructure would not really be until next spring.
The cost of the housing, what kind of price are we
sure.
looking at?
If you would look at it in terms of the low end of the housing scale, you're probably looking at about $165,000 to $175,000. But you know, that it would be what I consider to be market rate housing, that's affordable housing that many middle income people could afford and very compatible with existing development. And if one has a great keen interest in providing market rate affordable housing, this is probably the site that I can envision it most being produced upon, more so than anything else that I'm aware of out in the Southwest Durham area.
Okay, thank you.
Recognize Councilman Brown and then Councilwoman Cotardi.
Mayor Pro Tem asked several of my questions. I have driven this area. I intend to support this proposal, and I think that Mr. McKissick, your comment about affordable housing, which we're going to be talking about later this evening, is very salient. We have houses now and at the Southside development that the city has been involved with, and those houses are selling for probably $270,000 to $290,000 with some financial assistance from Duke. But I think as a real estate broker in Durham since 1980, this is a very good target for first-time buyers. And frankly, we need more houses in this price range, not less. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Recognize Councilwoman Cotardi.
Thank you, Mayor. I wanted to start by asking staff if they have these as committed elements.
Thank you, Councilmember Cotardi. We were just handed a written version by the applicant. We had seen a version of these earlier today, and they are acceptable. They seem to be legal and enforceable. There was a conflict on the timing of the sidewalk, whether it's prior to the platting of the 40th lot or prior to the 40th CO. We can accept either, but we need clarification on that. But otherwise, this appears to be clear, legal, and enforceable.
So I think you're saying, staff, that you're waiting for an answer from the developer on whether that's platting or CO, correct?
It was at the platting. That's my understanding, the platting. Is that your, Mr. Medlin, would that be correct?
Steve Medlin with the Planning Department. The proffers asked, submitted to the staff by the applicant, are acceptable and enforceable, as Mr. Young indicated.
Okay, thank you. I was wondering if the applicant could comment about the connection to MLK, since that was raised by citizens.
Sure. At this point in time, it's not anticipated that it will be a connection to MLK. At the same time, obviously, when things move forward, if there's an opportunity to come up with something that would work logistically that could be approved by staff, I think the applicant would be open to it. But it's not anticipated right now that it will be a connection to MLK.
Did you want to comment at all about your efforts to explore the feasibility of that
sure.
at this point and why you're not committing to it? Thanks.
Well, at this point in time, just in terms of being logistically able to do it, to accomplish it, would be a fairly challenging task. And of course, I can also look to Mr. Tate if you'd like to speak further on that.
We did talk with the City Real Estate Department about the triangular 1 acre piece that's the northeast corner and has frontage on MLK. We assume that that would be excess property and we could venture to buy that. The problem was we still needed 60 foot at that point to get enough right of way to have any kind of connection to MLK. And the apartment, first, I can't think of the name of it now, the apartment there is a HUD financed apartment, and there was no way they could, while the owner of that apartment was lives in the Outer Banks here in North Carolina, was happy to try to help us. There was no way he could get the land or an easement out from under the HUD financing mechanism.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's helpful. I did go out to the site, and I wanted to say that I, too, find it to be a reasonable use. I think 4 units per acre, single family, is appropriate for this area. And I, too, think that the higher density does provide more opportunities for affordable housing. My first home in Durham, we were on 1/6 of an acre lots, and that's how we were able to, given land prices, afford our first home. So, thanks.
Other comments, questions on this item? Recognize Councilwoman Shule.
This is a question for our transportation staff, which is, can you explain to me what the, once Fayetteville Road is, the widening is completed, it will be a right in, right out at Bell Green, is that right?
Yes, as part of the Fayetteville Road widening, it'll be to essentially a 4-lane divided section in there, so there'll be a median in Fayetteville and an additional north and southbound lane in each direction, which will basically, Bell Green will become right in, right out at that point.
So no one will be able to turn left onto Fayetteville Road out of Bell Green?
Correct. Exiting Bell Green, they'll have to turn right and go north on Fayetteville, and conversely, coming back in the evening, they'll have to go south past down the Barbie.
So does this make you anticipate that people who might have been, how will someone who is currently going south on Fayetteville Road out of Bell Green, how might they now best travel? How would they best travel south after the, or most likely travel south after the construction of the new lanes? Would they go out Arrindo?
some of them may, I would think. Depends probably where you live within the 95 units. Some of them may continue down Martin Luther King Jr. Parkway and go in through the Lockside neighborhood there. That would be a number of basically right turns versus continuing south and having to make the left at Barbie. But.
Recognize Councilwoman Katani.
Thank you. I apologize. I didn't read half my notes, so I just wanted to say that I do appreciate the concerns that have been expressed by the neighbors. I do think that the proffer of the sidewalk will go a long way towards helping with the safety issue. So just wanted to add that. Thank you.
I'd like to ask the developers, much has been said about doubling the density. You've got how many homes there now? Is it, you're talking about 95 units, so I'm trying to understand doubling the density.
In terms of the existing number of homes around in that area and that other adjoining development?
Lockside has 185 in the townhouse single-family section of Lockside. The property to the east, where just below the number 3, Cornwallis Village, there's 77 on the west side of Yorktown, and I think there's 115 on the west side of Yorktown. And then there's 50 just due south of the intersection of Yorktown and Odyssey. And that's all. I did not count the lots over in Robinwood or Dino. It is not a large number of lots.
Relative then, you didn't raise the question. Someone in the neighborhood raised the question. Could you explain how 95 homes doubles the density? That's what I'm trying to.
I don't think that it does. I mean, I think it's all a matter of scope and perspective and how large the neighborhood is. If you look at the immediately adjoining neighborhood, you will not even come close. I mean, 95 lots is half of the size. Now, if you look at it being sitting there as vacant earth today, fallow ground, then yes, there are going to be more traffic generated from it, but it couldn't remain vacant forever. So, I mean, the comprehensive plan anticipates 4 to 8 units per acre. This is coming in at the very low end of that density range at 4 units per acre, not up at the 8, not up at 6. And I know that hours and hours of time from our staff and from the public go into these comprehensive plans. And I think we should look at those plans and respect their integrity. And when it happens that a project comes in right there, square, within the confines of the comprehensive plan and the ordinance, I would hope that council would support it, particularly since the traffic issues, I think, have been appropriately addressed by the staff from our transportation department.
Well, I noticed one of the residents had a had a hand up. Since the resident raised the question, you have a comment you want to speak to that? Can you come to the microphone, please?
I just want to answer that question. Okay, so with respect to why we're saying doubling the density, the site is about a 24-acre site, a little less than 24 acres. So that's 48 units that would be able to be built under RS-20. They're proposing 95. So that's where we're getting doubling density from. And I'd like to take exception to what was said by the transportation staff member about how you would go south. You cannot go south on MLK. There's no access to MLK. And the likely route, the question of the likely route, is probably down a Silver Star Drive in Lockside because we don't have speed humps. The other alternative is down Robinwood Drive, which does have speed humps. And as far as, you know, the traffic, we have a church on that corner that has three services every Sunday, and during the week, each congregation has it, and they drive past Silver Star too. So our issue is, if you have a traffic issue, don't make it worse, and that's why we feel the RS-20 is reasonable for this area to preserve the property values that we have invested in. Thank you.
Could a developer speak to the question of why not R-20 versus what you're proposing?
In terms of the infrastructure for the site, what it would cost to develop it, it would not be financially viable or feasible to do the type of development that would be anticipated, and particularly to offer affordable housing options if you simply have an R-20 zoning in this area. It would be deeply concerning, challenging to do. There certainly would not be any ability to proffer the sidewalk, which is now being constructed all the way to Federal Road, or the money for Durham Public Schools, or to be able to accomplish the goals of developing this in conformance with the comprehensive plan. And I think one issue came up about safety. I don't know anything inherently unsafe about single-family detached housing any of itself in this area. And certainly if it's about pedestrian safety, the sidewalk will substantially enhance safety for pedestrian traffic.
Did someone else have a question to my left? I didn't see if you raised it. Let me share my comments on this item. I obviously am very familiar with the area. My company's right next to it, so I go there every day. I understand some of the traffic issues, depending on the time of day that you go there, in the morning and in the evening, trying to make the turn into Bell Green or make the turn out of Bell Green. I guess I'm also trying to be sensitive to concerns that persons who have invested in that neighborhood have about the change in the complexity of the neighborhood as opposed to what it is now, and that's why I asked why move from R-20 into a higher density development. I obviously have thoughts about affordable homes. My focus has been not market rate housing. My focus has been less than that, and I'll speak to that later. But I just have that concern about changing the complexity of that neighborhood, given what's already there and what's in existence. I think the traffic issues are an issue. Obviously, our traffic engineers have spoken about the capacity of that road. That's one thing. It's another thing to actually experience what you have to do when you're going into that neighborhood and coming out of that neighborhood. I value the offer of sidewalks. I think that obviously would be an improvement. I doubt if you would get sidewalks if this developer weren't proposing it. I understand the concern about the safety of the children who go to school there, who walk up to Bell Green to either make the bus or go to Pearson Town or wherever they are. So having said that, that's my reluctance for supporting this, but I'll vote at the appropriate time. And if there are no further questions, I'm going to close the public hearing. The matter is back before the council for a motion.
Move the item.
It's been properly moved. Is there a second? It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, we open the vote. Those voting for, we hit plus. Those voting negative, we hit minus.
Are you abstaining, Ms.? Did you mean to vote yes? It passes 5-2 with Mayor Bell voting no and Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden voting no.
Thank you. Let's move to the next item. The consistency statement. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Move to item 40, Unified Development Ordinance, text amendment, affordable housing, parking, and density bonus.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Aaron Kane with the Durham City County Planning Department. I'll be brief in my comments. You have the staff report in front of you, but I basically want to bring up this text amendment is before you as part of our four-part strategy for affordable housing in transit areas. There are basically two parts to this. The first is regarding parking for affordable housing dwelling units. The text amendment before you would remove the requirement for off-street parking provision for units that are deemed as affordable housing and are newly defined in the Unified Development Ordinance as a part of this amendment. Parking may still be provided, however, it is not required, and we have not changed any of the maximum parking rates for the compact neighborhood tier. Oh, I'm sorry, this is to remove the requirement for parking in the compact neighborhood tier. The second part is regarding the affordable housing density bonus, which has been on the books for 12 years but has never been utilized. This would increase the density bonus in the compact neighborhood tier to 3-1 while leaving it at 1-1 for the rest of the tiers in the city and county. It would add a height bonus to accommodate any increased density that came from the affordable housing density bonus. It removes the additional density bonus for having 500 feet of frontage on a major thoroughfare. And this text amendment also, as I said before, clearly defines what an affordable housing dwelling unit is. These changes are proposed in light of the fact that the current affordable housing density bonus has never been used since its inception in 2003 and is in furtherance of the goal that the City Council passed, looking to try to get 15% of units affordable to 60% of area median income within a half mile of transit stations. Planning Commission recommended approval 10-1 at its June 9th, 2015 meeting. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Again, it's a public hearing. Let me ask the questions. I have some comments that I want to make, but I want to hear from the council first, and we have several people that have signed up to speak on this item. Are there any comments from the council this time? If not, then we'll go to the audience. We have two persons that have signed up to speak on this item. Is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item, either for or against? If not, let's do 6 minutes initially. Becky Winders and Spencer Bradford, in that order. Becky.
Mayor Bell, is that 6 minutes each speaker?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening. My name is Becky Winders, and I live at 1304 Seton Road. And I'm speaking on behalf of the Coalition for Affordable Housing and Transit. And I think we have some supporters in the audience, and I wonder if the people who are here to support the Coalition for Affordable Housing and Transit will please stand up. Thank you. Our group formed about a year and a half ago to promote affordable housing near stations for the future light rail system. We want to thank the council for its support of our resolution and for keeping focused on promoting affordable housing around transit since the resolution was passed. And we also want to thank the planning department for all of their hard work and professionalism and accessibility and all the many meetings and reports and research that's been done. And tonight we appreciate the opportunity to comment on this important element of the toolbox of incentives for private investment in affordable housing. We'd like to make three points. First, the coalition supports the density bonus and the parking reduction text amendment as it changes section six of the unified development ordinance, and we think this is a good first step in strengthening the incentives, but we still have more to go. Second, we would like to ask you to amend the conceptual framework of the UDO to clarify the concepts of downtown and compact neighborhoods by adding the community's vision of equity, socioeconomic diversity, and affordability in Durham's densely urban areas. As currently written, the definitions and purpose statements in the UDO speak only to density and to the physical characteristics of development. Adding equity and diversity values would change the framework for designing and evaluating development. Perhaps socioeconomic impacts of plans and proposals could be evaluated along with impacts on infrastructure and the environment. And who knows, maybe we might conclude that negative social impacts of intense urban development would require mitigation. So we have suggested some wording here, and I know that we're coming in late with this proposed change after probably to the text amendment. I may have gotten my first draft of this thing about it in late February or early March. It's taken a while to absorb how the Unified Development Ordinance works, kind of. And our group got together and talked about how the resolution should be reflected in the development ordinances. And so we just we have some suggestions here just to make it convenient and easy. And the words in red are the words in black here are the current what's currently in the UDO, and the red words are our suggested changes. And so we have at the beginning as a whereas for the text amendment, if you decide that you could add this to the current text amendment, you could just add that. Okay. But, you know, the council has already passed this goal. You know, we've agreed on this goal, so that's the reason we're now asking to codify that goal in the UDO itself. And here are the areas. Actually, the first two are definitions of the compact neighborhood tier and the downtown tier, and those are actually definitions in the UDO that are restated from the comprehensive plan. So if we were not going to stick it in the current text amendment, there should be a plan amendment also. And then we found three zoning districts that relate to the transit stops that are compact districts the kind of zoning you would have in these intense urban areas that we're trying to create or that are happening. So we have the residential compact district, the downtown design district, and the compact design district, adding some words to those definitions. Currently, as you read them there, you know, they just talk about density and pedestrian activity, and that is what is in the plan, but I really don't think that's what the community wants the area to be. So finally, we need to keep on working to strengthen the regulatory incentives, and thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Next is Spencer Bradford.
Good evening. My name is Spencer Bradford. I live at 1613 Acadia Street in Durham. I'm executive director of Durham Congregations in Action. And on behalf of our board, I wanted to come tonight to express our support for these revisions to the Unified Development Ordinance and appreciation for the work and responsiveness of the Planning Department on this. As the first of many stages that will be needed to carry out the commitment that you've made to preserving 15% affordable housing around the light rail transit. We do want to also support the, as members of the Affordable Housing and Transit Coalition, express support for their recommendations to more particularly engage the goals of equity and diversity in the development ordinance decisions that are made, simply because of the length of time of work that's going to be needed over the years to meet our goal, and the additional tools that will be needed, the tools of the bonuses that are addressed in these revisions, we know are going to be important for the work that you and the city do to maintain the affordable housing stock in our community. And we would just like to see additional tools come into play to help make those very challenging goals more attainable for us all together. Thank you for your time.
You're welcome. We have another gentleman that would like to speak. Let's do this.
He has signed up for the unpaid subcontractors.
Oh, okay. Well, that isn't, you explained that that's not where we are. No, not now. Not now. Are there other persons that want to speak on this item, this being a public hearing item? If not, it's back to the council before I close the public hearing. I do have some comments, but I want to recognize my colleagues first, Councilman Brown, Councilwoman Cotati.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to ask our planning director to maybe answer a few questions. Where did Becky go? Becky? No. I wasn't calling you back. I was just wanted to thank you for coming this evening. And for admitting that you were somewhat late and tardy on this one. And you said that you've been working on this since late February and March. My calendar says it's August. Mr. Medlin, have you seen this before, this version?
Steve Medlin with the Durham Planning Department. A version of that was shared with the planning staff late last week by Councilmember Brown. We had an earlier version. Obviously, we haven't spent any significant time at this point evaluating what is being proposed. I would just go one step further and advise the council, and the attorney can step in here if he wishes, that whenever you do a text amendment, you don't have the luxury of writing text on the fly, especially when it's in different sections of the code than have been advertised for public hearing. If the council were interested in having the staff look at this, then it would be more appropriate just to refer it back to the staff to evaluate it, put it into the queue for us to consider. Is there an opportunity for it to be added to the work program, either if there is additional time this year or for consideration in next year's work program?
Thank you. I'd like to ask the city attorney basically the same question. And I guess the key question for me, not only, I guess you got this last week.
I got it tonight.
Oh, tonight.
Actually, I didn't get it tonight, but I passed it around tonight. There were only seven copies.
You're not worthy.
I'm not worthy.
You're not worthy. From what you garner from this, because I think you've got, is this actually legally enforceable?
So like Mr. Midland said, I don't like to give legal advice on the fly, particularly on something that I actually haven't seen, but I have heard about. So the gist is, and we've discussed this before, you certainly have some opportunities to incentivize affordable housing and to promote affordable housing. The issue of mandating affordable housing through some form of inclusionary zoning has been the issue that we've been struggling with, and we don't feel that you have the legal authority to do that. So again, I actually haven't seen this, and if it's been sent to me, I'm sorry, I haven't seen it. But that's always been sort of our bright line test of, you know, you can't mandate it, but for the discussions that you all are having for promoting it and incentivizing it, certainly reasonable.
Okay. Well, I want to thank both of you for your comments. I would certainly concur. We would send this back to the administration and the two key departments for further review. At least that would be my judgment.
Okay, let's recognize Councilwoman Cotardi and then Councilwoman Moffitt.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do appreciate the suggested revised language and definitely think it has merit, but again, it's not something we can do tonight. I do want to move the proposed UDO text change forward as written. I do believe that in the future, just as the planning director just said, that staff and JCCPC and others can take the language into consideration, possibly putting it in the queue and work program for this year. That's something JCCPC loves to weigh in on. I do want to highlight just a few efforts, which of course I think most of you know that planning for and redefinition of the compact neighborhoods is well underway. Staff are looking hard at that. They've had public meetings, and there'll continue to be a lot more discussion on that. Similarly, we have lots of ideas to be considered as both planning and community development staff move forward. Working with a planned housing consultant that's on our agenda on Thursday, we'll be talking more about that. Enterprise, I think, and the principal, Karen Lato, or, you know, we have been great expectations, I would say, for some of the things that they're talking about doing. And then lastly, we know that a UDO revision or overhaul is needed. It's 10 years old, and I won't admit to missing the opportunity to revise that 700 or 800 page document. I read it way too many times. So anyways, again, thank you. It's great language, and we'll look at it as we move forward, but not tonight. Thanks.
Ask Councilman Marfin.
I was just going to say what my colleague, Councilmember Cotardi, said, which is that I think that the staff recommendation is ready to move forward, that the other language that's been proposed this evening is, we can refer that back to staff for further consideration. Thank you.
Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have a question for staff. You cited the Charlotte and Asheville and Raleigh parking bonuses do they work? And will the density bonus work in a city with a residential market like Durham's? I mean, I'm definitely in favor of this. I think it's great to add it to the toolbox, but I have, I'm I wonder if you could just comment about the ability of these to actually make a difference.
I would say that it's possible that they can make a difference. I wouldn't say that we could say definitively that approving this will mean that there will be an increase in affordable housing development in these areas. There's no way to parse out or any sort of linear regression or any sort of analysis that's going to say these tools will be the exact thing in your market that will work. We have seen that density bonuses work in other places, but those tend to be areas that are much more expensive than we are in terms of residential development. Places like San Francisco, you know, Durham, people are talking about how expensive Durham is getting at $2 a square foot for residential rents. We see these work more when it's in the $4 to $6 a square foot, and we're not there yet. So I'm not sure that they will directly work, but I think they can be a piece in consideration with other things that will come about through Karen Lotto's work that I think that will all put together something that will work in the future.
Thank you. And can you talk a little bit about how a density bonus might possibly interact with zoning? That is, does this affect in some way how we should be zoning around the transit station? So should we think about zoning to try to find a sweet spot where it'll be more profitable for the developer to want the denser zoning with the affordable units than to build a less dense project by right? You know, is there thought about what kind of rezoning, possibly downzoning, should we be doing around the future transit stations that mm-hmm. might in some way interact with this density bonus? Or should it drive any kind of thinking like that?
That would be ideal, and I think in a perfect world, that's where we would end up, is finding that sweet spot. But I think finding that sweet spot is about as difficult as me hitting a Nolan Ryan fastball, so to speak. It's with market changes and market dynamics, being able to find exactly where that zoning is and where that density bonus is going to be very difficult. It would be dynamically changing over time. I think the other thing we need to take into consideration, as Councilor Cotati mentioned, our work on compact neighborhoods, we want to be cognizant of the fact that we may have two competing factors here, which is we want to make sure that we have policies and regulations in place that will encourage transit-oriented development and the kind of density and walkability for those areas. Yet we also have concerns that because of the lack of the ability to do mandatory inclusionary zoning in North Carolina, the rezoning tool is one of the only tools we have, one of the only sticks that we have to compel encourage a developer to proffer affordable housing. So we're going to have to really look at over time how we balance those two potentially competing policy goals and hopefully find the sweet spot that gets us both.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mayor, I have at some point after your, I have some comments about what you sent us in writing. I know you're going to comment about it. So if you don't mind, I'll just reserve that until after you're done. Is that good? Thank you. I want to add one more thing, Mr. Mayor, I'm sorry, which is my appreciation to the staff, which has been expressed before by my colleagues, but I know it took a tremendous amount of work to get to this Aaron and company. And so I just want to thank you for it. It's a good first step.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
I would just like for them to explore under the caption downtown design the definition of preserving equity. I think that's a term that we sort of use sort of lightly. So if you would tell me what that is, not tonight, because I don't think we want to keep downtown as it is.
Okay.
You don't want to preserve what it is. I think we need to enhance racial equity. I think we should have more specificity when we use equity. Thank you.
I have several comments, and I'm going to add to what my colleagues have said. I appreciate the effort that the staff has made. I know this is not an easy task by any stretch of imagination and trying to develop tools, but it is a tool that hopefully, if we adopt it, will be in the toolbox.
I have a couple of questions. One of the questions I have relates to the example that you gave relative to, I'll go specifically, it was item 2, compact neighborhood tier. Is anybody there?
Yeah. Drop something.
Okay.
Yes, Mr. Mayor.
What was the intent of paragraph 2? And sure. That's where you give an example that if you have a 5-acre project with a maximum allowable density of 60 units per acre, which would allow for 300 units, and of the 300 units, 15% would be affordable. Mm-hmm. What was the intent of that?
Just trying to provide an example so that there was more clarity than we find is currently in the ordinance regarding how the affordable housing density bonus works.
Okay, well, it seems to me that if someone is given and takes advantage of that, the net effect is you no longer have 15%, you have something less than 15%, like 10%. So that's
correct.
What I understand. That's what you understood?
Absolutely.
Okay. Let me tell you what I think is missing from this proposal. We keep speaking about affordable housing. I'm still not convinced that any developer is going to take advantage of this bonus density. That's just me. And I think one of the reasons is developers are still driven by the profit they're going to be able to make. Mm-hmm. They're driven by the revenue that they expect to receive from the units that they build. So if you tell a developer that you're going to provide him a bonus of letting him build, in this case, 45 more units, which you consider to be affordable. If I'm a developer, I want to say, okay, well, what kind of rents am I going to get from those extra units to get added to my total project? Well, you say it's affordable housing. That doesn't mean anything. I think we need to be very specific. I think we need to reference, not necessarily here, what we're speaking about in terms of affordable. I assume that we're speaking about those income, those families that are below the median income. That's where I am. And I think it would be important for a developer to know that if you're talking about an affordable unit, a family 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, mm-hmm. if you're talking about affordable units where you want the minimum incomes to be 60 to 80%, that he'd be able to go to some type of reference to say, okay, here's the income for a family at 80% medium income. Here's the expected rent that the person could pay. And so he's got something he can go and look at. But right mm-hmm. now, he doesn't have anything. So, you know, and so if I'm planning a project, I want to know where all my rents are coming from. And if I'm going to put 45 more units there, I want to know what kind of rents can I expect to receive from those units if they're affordable. You don't, it's not here. And I don't think it needs to be here. I think it needs to reference.
Okay.
And we have numbers, we have charts that speak about affordable incomes, and generally we talk about you know, it shouldn't be any more than 30% of what it is, but I just think we need to reference that in this document. Because otherwise, you're going to come up with a case where developers are not going to, you know, what can I charge? And what's affordable? What's a meaningful rent?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, I just wanted to point out, and it's kind of buried in the back, but if in the proposed amendment.
Show me where it's buried.
Page 11. It says 16.3 defined terms, and that is where we define what an affordable housing unit is. And
I'm sorry, I'm trying to go to what page is it?
Page 11 of attachment A.
That's the one I have here. So where's that? I'm on attachment A. I'm on page 11.
And as you'll see section 16.3 defined terms.
Okay.
And we're adding a definition of an affordable housing density, an affordable housing dwelling unit. So every time we refer to affordable housing dwelling unit in section 16.6, it refers to this definition. And that is where you can find that it is incomes at 60% or less of the area median family income for a family as defined by the United States Department of Housing and Urban Development. And at Housing and Urban Development, every year they publish.
You answered my question. I didn't
okay,
look far
great.
Enough. I appreciate that.
Sure.
Are there other comments? I recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yes. On Joint City County Planning Committee, we've been looking at this for several months. And I tend to agree that the density bonuses, I think we give away so much density by right, that density bonuses would be hard to be effective. But I think that the parking, that which I don't think that we should not do the density bonus. I just am not sure myself it's going to be that effective. The parking, change in parking requirements, I think, has an opportunity to be a real cost savings to the developer, and therefore to help move towards closing the gap, the financial gap that you were alluding to, Mr. Mayor. And I think that the height bonus has a possibility of increasing the profits on a particular piece of property, which will allow them to close the gap between the market rate and what we're calling affordable housing. And these are just the first set of tools. I mean, I believe that we're going to see a number of tools, additions to the toolbox over the next few months. And you might, I'll invite you to speak to that if you'd like.
Yeah, I'll speak to that as much as I can, as that will more likely be coming from community development and Karen Lotto and her group as they work forward, bringing to you proposals on financial strategies that can be used for affordable housing in these areas.
Can I go back? I congratulate you for having it in there, but the manager pointed it out to me also. What's missing is the rental income. You define what the medium family incomes are for, mm-hmm. et cetera. But the piece that's missing is generally we say that the income should be no more than 30%.
Correct.
But I'm saying that's not in here.
Okay.
So I think that's something that probably needs to be.
We can more clearly define that.
Steve, you have a comment on that?
Steve Medlin. We can certainly add that. We have a set of text amendments coming forward to you in the next 2 or 3 months, and we'll be glad to add that into those text changes coming to you, adding that clarification to it.
Well, that was the point, I guess, I was trying to make.
It's an easy recognize
thing. Councilman Moffitt.
I'm trying to read this too, because there's a lot of commas in here. It says it has to be committed as affordable as defined by HUD. Does HUD use the 30% in their definition?
No, but what HUD does is it defines the family incomes at various percentages. So it says what a median income is for the county by household size, and then we would take that and say the monthly 30% of that number is what the maximum rent would be in order to be classified as affordable. So, I think what the mayor's pointing out is that we're missing that 30% piece, and we need to add that in.
So I misread this then. So what I'm understanding you to say is that HUD defines what the area median income is.
Correct.
They don't define what affordable is.
Correct.
Okay.
We define what's considered affordable, they define what that income is.
And your intent is use 30, when you were looking at this, you were thinking 30% of?
Correct, yes, 30% of 60% of area median income.
Are there further questions, comments on this item? If not, again, this is a public hearing. Is anyone else that wants to speak on this particular item that we're discussing? Let the record reflect no one else asked to speak. I'll declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Is it open? Okay. Those voting for will hit plus. You close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
I recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yes. We had citizens bring forward recommended changes to the UDO this evening. I'd like to move that we refer those to Joint City County Planning Committee for. I'll look to you for the proper. What do you think? Should we refer them to staff or to JCCPC?
Staff.
I would recommend you refer it to staff.
Okay. So moved.
Second.
Properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? You close the vote.
Passes 7-0.
Excuse me, Mr. Mayor. We need a consistency statement on the text amendment.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. I'm going to defer my comments until we get through these relative to the affordable housing piece. So we move to item 41, Unified Development Ordinance Text Amendment.
Good evening, Steve Medlin with the Durham City County Planning Department. Unified Development Ordinance Text Amendment TC 15-00004 is a city and county initiated text amendment which proposes two minor changes to the ordinance. First, it would allow encroachments that would be allowed within the current no build 10-foot setback associated with riparian buffers in certain limited circumstances where encroachments are actually permissible by right under both state law and the Unified Development Ordinance. We've inadvertently created this 10-foot no man zone where we now would require all applicants to go to the Board of Adjustment for a variance. We feel like allowing what is already allowed in the buffer in the no build area would make sense. Second, we would like to change the definition of lot of record. Our current definition of lot of record only references the Durham County Register of Deeds. As the council is aware, we have jurisdiction in both Wake County and Orange County, and we just need to make sure that our ordinance references the appropriate Register of Deeds office. Planning Commission did recommend approval of this item by a vote of 11-1 on June 9th, and staff is recommending approval, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Again, this is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. Do council members have any questions of the staff on the presentation? Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect no one in the audience asked to speak on this item. The public hearing is closed. Matters back before the council. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Those voting for will hit plus. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Move the consistency statement.
Will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Move to item 43, private drainage assistance cost sharing interest rate, section 70-687 and 70-688.
Good evening, Mayor Bell and council members. I'm Dana Horncole with the Public Works Department. This public hearing is being held to receive comments on two proposed revisions to the Durham Code of Ordinances related to the private drainage assistance program. This program was created at the request of council to assist property owners with failing drainage systems affecting their home, or either their primary ingress or egress, forgive me. The first revision of section 70-687 of the code would raise the limit on the city's contribution towards these typical projects from $20,000 to $25,000. This would reflect increases in construction costs as well as the size and complexity of our typical projects. This would meet council's goal to cover 80% of the cost of these typical projects. The second revision of section 70-688 would set the interest rate for installment payments annually for property owners who choose to pay their portion of the cost share via installment payments. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
The public hearing is open. Are there questions by comments by councils? Anyone in the audience wants to speak on this item? Let the record reflect no one asked to speak. The public hearing is closed. Matters are put to council. Been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Okay. I have some comments that I want to make relative to this, my proposal for city rental assistance program for low medium income families. But before I do that, these people have been waiting so long, they might not have understood our process. So if there's one spokesman that would like to make comments, I'd invite you to come up, and if you could limit them to 3 minutes. The gentleman here, you wanted to make a comment? Did you want to make a comment? Just one person. And if you could just state your name and address, please.
Good evening, and thank you for letting me speak with you. We're here, we've been protesting for 3 weeks. We've been working hard in a Marriott hotel. And I think it's in your hands the help we are looking for. Because Many families were affected. Some people haven't been paid since December, January. I heard some people were have accident and were fired, and that's unfair. And it's on your hands. They are making money now, and the job is done. So it's unfair that they've been getting money, and we are waiting for money since 6 months ago. So as a city council, you have in your hands the opportunity to take the permits away or to take the tax break away from them. Because if you don't do nothing, the owner will do nothing. The subcontractor say, he will do nothing. He will not pay us. And that's unfair. We have families. I have 6 kids. 5 of them will back at school next week. How do I gonna buy the school supplies if they don't pay me? I mean, I'm not asking nothing for free. I'm just asking for my money. And to understand that people, we have to wear their shoes. You know what I'm saying? And it's not just me. There is at least subcontractors, and each subcontractor has families that depend on them. In my case, I have 5 employers. They were dependent on me. And they had to look for something else because I couldn't pay them. How can I pay them if they don't pay me? And the same happened with Luis, with Mariano, with some other guys that they already gone. But we have, it's in your hands. I think you can help us. I mean, we pay taxes. You are giving to Concord Hospitality $1.3 million to break a tax break. And you can help us with that. While you are giving them money, they are taking more money from us. Do you think it's fair that? I think it's unfair. Now, we are here to tell you that you can take the permits out and the tax breaks out from them. And I think you can help us. We are here because we know you can help us. This is on your hands. So I like you, like as a council you are, I like you to act soon because you don't know the families, how they're suffering. I mean, you are up, we are down. I'm sorry. All right. Thank you.
You're quite welcome. Let me, we have a policy that we don't do signs in the council chambers, if you don't mind. We appreciate if you could lower those. We spoke to this item a little bit earlier during the agenda, and obviously it didn't come through as to what we said. So I'm going to ask the city attorney if he could just explain the city's position. And I'll say 2 things. It's not all in our hands, and he'll speak to that. The other piece is we can't take anything away from them because we have not given them any tax breaks as such. So we haven't given them any money yet. They have to meet certain terms before that happens. So that hasn't happened yet. But I'll turn it over to the city attorney to let him explain our position.
And just to be clear, the issue is the dispute resolution that exists between the contractors or the subcontractors that aren't paying you. There are policies and procedures in place that should allow you to get relief from them, and would encourage you to pursue that. We're not in direct contract with you, so if you were city employees, it would be a completely different situation. But at this stage, and my office has looked at it in the event that, because I've gotten calls from council members about, is there anything that we can do? And it's not that, I'm not sure if I should speak for council. It's not that we don't care or aren't interested in it. I think that this council is on record as being very concerned about these issues, particularly when it comes to wages and being paid a fair, livable wage. But it's not exactly completely in our hands, and I would encourage you all to to pursue the resolutions, whether it's, you know, going to court or bringing, I think it mentioned was involving the Department of Labor in here, because if there are unfair labor practices, those are things that can be addressed, particularly at the state government level.
Let me, if you're going to speak, come to the podium, but I'm not going to prolong this. I appreciate the fact that you came here. Like the city attorney says, we're all sensitive and concerned about the issues. I mean, if you work, you ought to get paid. That's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. So that's not a question with us. But there are legal procedures that have to be followed. And while you say it's in our hands, it's not in our hands in that respect. But I see the city manager has a comment he wants to make. And
right, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was just going to make the comment that during the course of the meeting, I stepped in the back and spoke to a representative from Durham Can and Congregations in Action, and asked them if he could have his organization take a look at that. We exchanged some contact information from this gentleman and him, and he's going to try to do that tomorrow to see what resources those organizations might have to see if they can lend to help this situation. Can't do anything about that tonight, but at least I think there's at least an exchange, and he indicated they potentially, you know, could find someone to help. So hopefully that will be another avenue. And as I indicated, our staff will continue to try to work through the situation to the extent we have any ability to do that, and encourage all the parties involved to continue to sit down and try to reach an understanding of you know, the facts and what can be agreed to.
Councilman Shule, because I really want to close this out.
I'll be brief. All right. I appreciate what the manager said, and thank you for working on that, Mr. Manager, and trying to get some help from Durham Can and Durham Congregations in Action, and I think they can be helpful. But I do want to reiterate what I said earlier, which is I think that we do have the what you're calling the tax break, the incentive. It's a long time before this would be due to them. It's well over a year, is my understanding. But I do think that we ought to be keeping that in mind, and that we should not be, if we are uncomfortable that this has been worked out satisfactorily and fairly, then I think that we ought to be using that as leverage. And we don't want to be incentivizing a development that is not paying its workers as it should. We can't decide that. We can't adjudicate that. That somebody else has got to do that. But I do think we ought to be keeping our eyes on it and using that if we need to. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes that conversation. You have the contact. They know who to contact. And as the manager indicated, we'll follow it as closely as we can. Okay, having said that, I shared with the city council persons on this, and the city manager and the city attorney, a proposal that I would like the council to seriously consider, and it involves the city rental assistance program for Durham below medium income families for targeted areas of our city. And I'm not going to read this. Let me tell you what the net of it is. I'm of the firm belief that if this city council is serious about the fact that it would like to see more below medium income families occupying units in the downtown area, and the downtown area can be defined, as well as around transit stops within a half mile radius, that we need to begin working on that now. I appreciate the tools that are being proposed by the staff. We just passed one. I know that at our Thursday meeting, we're going to hear from the administration on the proposal for having a consultant to come in and look at this whole issue of affordable housing in our city. But I think we have within our means to move on this now. And my proposal is laid it out. What I would like to do when the city works with this administrative person that we're looking at, this consultant, to make that one of the priorities that that person looks at. I'm not comfortable with waiting until the study is done before we do anything. This is something we can do now. And my proposal lays out the steps that I think need to be taken. It lays out the assumptions. But the bottom line is that we have units that have already been built in this community. We have units that are coming out of the ground in this community. We have units that are on the planning board to be built. And they aren't going to wait around for us to adopt an affordable housing program to make that happen. Because if they meet the zoning requirements, if it's non-discriminatory in what they're doing, they can build these things. And they can charge whatever rents they want. The market will determine that. I'm suggesting that we put a plan in place that basically would provide rental assistance to families that meet the qualifications that are below the median income, and I'm speaking about ranges from 60 to 80%, that families have a certain residency in this community, because I don't want a program that suddenly everybody and his mother moves to Durham because they want to take advantage of it. I think people should have had some type of commitment living here before they are able to participate in the program. I think we have a revenue source that this council adopted a year ago, where we put 1 cent on the property tax for, quote, affordable housing. It's a stream that brings in $2.4 million a year, unless what happens that suddenly the 1 cent isn't worth what it is. But we've got money there. I know that some of those funds have been committed for certain projects. I know that there are administrative costs that will be required to handle a program such as this. But we don't have to wait. We aren't going to force developers to admit people into their units unless they can get the rent from it. And we know that some of these units are just not affordable for persons that we're targeting. Again, the areas we're talking about is downtown Durham and around the proposed transit stops. I'm more concerned right now in downtown Durham, because the transit system isn't here yet, and we still got to go through it. But we've got units downtown that we can do that with. And I've laid that out to the council, to the colleagues, to give examples. And I think that it's something that we ought to seriously consider. And I think if we got to have a consultant come here talking about affordable housing and how we do affordable housing, I would like them to consider that as one of the priorities. Because as I understand what's going to be presented, we'll talk about this, that program is going to be almost 18 months away. It's done in phases. It's not just for a particular area. You're talking about affordable housing throughout the city of Durham, and that's not where I am. I'm for a very targeted area. I'm for a very targeted group of families. I'm very targeted for the revenue stream that can do that. This doesn't preclude, if developers want to do something on their own, they can do it. If they want to make use of this bonus that we've got here, they can do that. But I'm saying this addresses the need today for existing projects today and projects that are coming out of the ground. Quite frankly, we should have done it, in my opinion, when we granted the developer an incentive for building this 26-story tower. I mean, that would have been a perfect place. And it's still not too late for that. Because all that I'm saying, I'm not asking developers to do anything less. I'm just saying that you'll be guaranteed your rent that you're asking for if these people qualify, and we make up the difference between the market rate and what the families can afford. And again, you've got the details, so I don't have to hassle through that. But that's something I want to discuss at our work session. The manager won't be there, but I've had discussion with him also, so that's the purpose of bringing it up now. Councilman Shule has some comments that he wants to make, and I'm sure I'm going to be able to respond to him when he makes them. Go ahead.
Yeah. Could I? Oh.
Mayor Pro Tem, I'm sorry.
I thank you for your vision, Mr. Mayor. As you know, I am from the school called Affirmative Action, and I think that you have to take affirmative steps to make things happen. They might not be the way we've done it in the past, but we need to look at different ways of making things happen. And this is an affirmative action step that we need to take. I'm a taxpayer. All of us are taxpayers. There are taxpayers who really want us to do something to make a difference, not to keep studying, but to actually take affirmative steps. And I define this vision as an affirmative action measure. Thank you, sir.
Councilman Shule.
I'm surprised to hear you think you're going to have some comments after mine, Mr. Mayor. I wanted to just, I really appreciated what you brought forward and have been thinking about it since you sent it to us a couple days ago and just had some comments I wanted to add. I'll tell you, there are several things about it I really like. One is that it is an action step. And the second is, I really agree with you that while we need to be, we have a fabulous consultant who we're about to vote on Thursday, and I think they're a great company, and I'm really excited about them. But I also agree with you that when we see a good, clear path to act upon, in the meantime, while the consultant's report's being written, we ought to be doing it when we can. And the other thing about that is, it's clear to me, I mean, we all know, but I don't think it's clear to our public that we're already doing a ton of affordable housing stuff right now. The first 80 units of Southside, subsidized units are already rented out. Excuse me, Mr. Mayor. The 48 home ownership units, the $500,000 that we just gave to the Durham Housing Authority to leverage the redevelopment of Marion Road and Daymar Court, the support for the new 20 units in Goley Point, the $200,000 for rapid rehousing, the $1 million for the Habitat homes, and so forth. The PRIP program, so all that we're already doing, and shouldn't we wait if we don't need to wait, if we have the right plan, but we aren't waiting. And so the other thing I want to say that I like about what you proposed is it uses the penny for more than bricks and mortar. In the past, I think that has been a point of contention, and I understand why. We did put in the rapid rehousing money, and now this would use the penny for a rent subsidy. And when appropriately applied, I think that's a good thing. So those are the things I really like. Let me tell you what my questions are. I want to just think about some of the alternatives. I guess my main question is kind of the population this is aimed at. People making 80% of the AMI, the area median income, the upper range of what you've targeted, are making $43,000 for a family of two. So these people, I believe, have housing options in many neighborhoods in town at market rates. So for example, someone making $43,000, 80% of the AMI, if they're paying 30% of their income in rent, would be able to pay about $12,900 per year in rent. That's about a little over $1,000. It's almost $1,100 per month. So my question, Mr. Mayor, would be, as we think through this, is do we want to be using our scarce penny for housing money to subsidize people who are able to pay that market rate, and to do so to be paying, say, anywhere between, well, let's just take kind of your midpoint number of $500,000 every single year to subsidize that. So my thought that I would hope that we would also think about is, if we're going to be using the penny for housing money to pay rent subsidies, I'd like it also to think about subsidizing at a lower percentage of the AMI for thinking about our needier families. And I'm in favor of that. So I like your idea in that way, but I think we ought to be thinking about subsidizing down the income scale. And I could talk more about that. But what that doesn't solve, though, I think that something that you're rightly targeting, Mr. Mayor, which is, because that would not be in the core of downtown. So how would you have deeply affordable housing downtown? And I think there that we already know a lot of what our strategies are, because we've thought about them, or in some cases done them. And the first is to be leveraging our publicly owned land, which you've spoken out of in favor of, Mr. Mayor, and many of us have, to get that housing built. We know these sites are downtown in proximity to the light rail corridor. And I believe in mixed income neighborhoods. I'm not as concerned that every housing project be mixed income. So I think, you know, let's use our scarce tax money and the penny for housing as widely as we can to leverage as many affordable units as we can. And I think we can do that by using that money to leverage those projects using publicly owned land. along with a 9% tax credit or even the 4% non-competitive tax credit when we can, and possibly with the local financial contribution come from the penny for housing money. And I think we can build hundreds of units downtown, in and around downtown, that are affordable in the 60% range and lower if we do that. And then briefly, my second strategy is something we've done already very well, which is to look for other opportunities such as the Community Development Department found in the last couple of years to keep multifamily apartments coming out of mandated affordability periods affordable for another 15 to 30 years. We've done this successfully three times in the last couple of years by providing renovation money in small amounts as the landlords needed to renovate their apartments after 15 years of use. By providing this money, we allow these landlords to guarantee another 15 years of deeply affordable rent. I think we should be aggressively seeking those opportunities, and I think that that would be a great expenditure of the penny and a tremendous amount of bang for the buck. And I also want to add one more thing, which is I don't think we ought to let our developers off the hook on this. I know that we're not able to require inclusionary zoning when it comes to apartments because the General Assembly won't let us. But in Chapel Hill now, the president of the Durham Orange Home Builders Association is chairing a committee to standardize developers' voluntary contributions to an affordable housing fund as they build in Chapel Hill. And I think we should take that schedule of contributions and adapt it to Durham in ways that make sense for us. And I think we will get, if we set a standard, what we expect when people come to Durham, that we will get significant compliance with those wishes. So I think there's a lot to like about your idea, Mr. Mayor, and I'm happy to push it forward for discussion as you'd like to do, but I think there are other ways it can be modified to serve us better, and I think there are other strategies we ought to be thinking of at the same time. So thank you.
You're welcome. let me come back to my basic premise. Not my basic premise, what this council said. I didn't choose 80%, the council chose 80%. They said 60 to 80%. Very emphatic when we adopted the resolution, 60 to 80% around transit stops. We didn't say only 80%, we said 60 to 80%. I'll present this at the council. Thanks to Councilman Moffitt, because he did one thing and I just expanded it on the example that you gave. We constantly hear about downtown. I know what we're doing over in Rolling Hills. I mean, I know very well what we're doing over there. I know what we're doing all around this community relative to affordable housing. And I want to get off the affordable housing. I know what we're doing relative to families who have incomes below the median. That to me is what we're talking about, not affordable housing in general. I know what we're doing there. I know also what we're doing downtown. I know all the units that have been built. I'd be very surprised at the number of below medium income families that are living in Westwood Village, Wheatstone, all the other apartments that are around here, in terms of what Roger Perry is coming out of the ground with, in terms of what this 26-story unit is coming out of the ground with. I'd be very surprised if any of the people that we're talking about, or very few if any, are going to live in those developments unless we provide some type of assistance, or unless the developer does it. And I'm not precluding the developer. If the developer wants to say, okay, I'm willing to set aside X number of units for persons below medium, that's great. I'm not saying precluding that. But I think we've got to take some action ourselves. And this is a very simple process. I'll give you an example. You talked about the medium incomes. I asked for incomes for families at 80%, 60%. What is the medium income for that? For one person, it's $37,000+. At 60%, it's $28,000+. If you take 30% of that, the person that is at 60% is $8,400 annually. If you take 80% of, if you take 30% of 80%, it's $11,000. Then you're going to look at the apartments, and thanks to Don, he gave me a rental schedule for the West Village. I don't know if it's right or wrong, but I'm accepting that. If you take an example of a person who has one person in the family, they're making 60% of the medium income. A one-room apartment would require that person to pay $15,000 a year. If we subsidize that, that person can get an apartment by paying $712 a year. The 80% person, the 60% person has to pay $12,000. So you might not give that money, might not choose that person. You can go to a person that has a family of two in it. That the median income for 80% is $48,000. For 60%, it's $32,000. For the 80% person, the maximum that they could pay for rent is $12,000 annually. For the 60% person, the maximum they could pay for rent is $9,700. If they tried to go into a one-bedroom apartment in West Village, where the monthly rent is $1,400, or for a two-bedroom is $1,900, let's move into the one-bedroom apartment. $1,400, you'd have to substitute that person $712 to get them into that apartment. We can go down the line. Take a person that's got four people in it, and maybe you don't want to put them in. They wouldn't fit into a one-bedroom apartment, but if they did, you subsidize them $600 a month. The point is that we can make this happen. I'm not saying you've got to use all the money. We certainly put a cap on how much of the money we're going to use, but you can do it. It's not rocket science. I think if you had a consultant and if she's anywhere worth her, what she's proposing, she could very quickly develop a program along this line. And if she can't, then I got some problems with it because I'm going to ask some questions along the line when she comes in. But I'm not precluding the other things you're talking about. I'm saying this is a very specific plan that this city can take. If we're serious about having persons between 60 and 80% living downtown, if we're serious about having persons between 60 and 80% living around transit stops, and if you don't have a developer that's going to build it for them, and we can't control it, they're going to go there. So that's my conversation, and that's the conversation I'll have Thursday. And I think, again, if we're serious, we can make it work.
Yeah, the only thing I would say, excuse me, we are recommending hiring a firm that has a fairly substantial number of consultants. It's not just one person. That just be careful. I mean, I didn't want to just. Well, there is a lead person. Okay. I didn't mean it to you. I just you know, the capabilities are very broad. So hopefully we'll have a variety of options that can come back and address some of these issues.
The money's there. The capacity is there. The need is there. We can make it happen.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. Could you, on Thursday, have our staff your definition of downtown?
Yeah. Well, that's a good point, because I think that's what we've got to make sure of the area we're talking about in terms of downtown. Just like we're talking about the area around the transit stops, we need to make sure we understand what downtown is and what those things are.
And I certainly concur with you in terms of the focus right now should be on downtown because the transit, well, that could be 10 or 15, 20 years away.
Okay, any other comments, any other business? That's not debatable. We adjourn at 9:30 p.m. Thank you. Okay.